Powerful, exposing, and true. DPB. Fighting corruption for you. It's the David Paul Bloom and Shine Show.
I keep trying to find a life on my own apart from you.
Yes, it is. It is the DPB Show. I'm David Paul Bloom and Shine here at Cities 92.9, the news and talk of Bloomington Normal. Hey, it's amazing how quickly a week goes by. The temperatures are on the rise. People are out gardening. People are out, farmers are out in the fields. That's always one of the things that I enjoy. I don't know about you. It's one of the best parts about living in Illinois. I consider this the greatest state in the nation. Obviously, we talk here about what's wrong with Illinois a lot because there's plenty that's wrong. And we're going to get to that here quickly. The biggest thing I think we face here is this primary season coming up. They've moved this date back to June 28th, and we're seeing the fever pick up. And once again, I'm not here to bash J.B. Pritzker. There'll be time for that. That happens after June 28th. Plenty of fodder for that. Obviously, the state is in a desperate condition under the rule of J.B. Pritzker. Now, J.B. himself thinks that he's balanced the budget, which he has contended that he has done for the 3 years that he's been in office. There's nothing further from the truth. I invite you to go out and look at the auditor. Just Google the Illinois Auditor General's report of 2021. It's fascinating. It states there in the accountability that this auditor general doesn't even have enough data from the different agencies to compile an accurate report on the finances of Illinois. However, the leadership of the state is saying that everything's in the up and up. In fact, JB's even touting that we've had 6 credit rating increases. He doesn't mention the fact that we had 20 decreases over the time. So I guess if my math serves me right, that means we're still about 14 is the net. Nate, is that how your math?
I think that's how math works, David.
Well, so if you hear the voice, that's Nate Byrne. He's one of our contributors here on the DPB show. He's been busy the last couple of months, but it's good to see him back in studio with us. He's going to be my sidearm here because we've got to definitely cover this today. And this is what we're calling the deception of the primary of 2022. We have a candidate that has been put forth, infiltrated the Republican Party based on a plethora of different contributors, mostly one, the richest man in Illinois, Ken Griffin, which now he has amassed $45 million in his campaign war chest. And that is none other than the guy you hear frequently on commercials and radio, and especially the biggest thing is he has been pushing himself into your household unannounced by dropping junk mail in your mailbox. And that is Richard Irvin, who is not a Republican, yet he is running as one. We have proof. The King County clerk has put forth his voting record. He is a registered Democrat. He can't run from it. He won't answer questions. He won't show up to forums. What do we need to do as Christian conservative Republicans approaching this thing? I believe we need to do one thing. And that one thing might be different for everybody, but you got to do something. Get involved. Call this out. I still find it fascinating that people get these, Nate, and they believe this. I mean, some of these things, Nate was just saying he's going to hand me these things and we can deal with them. You know, I've got 12 mailers from Richard Irvin.
It's a thick pile.
It's a thick pile. And the statements that he makes, and once again, getting back to Reagan's philosophy, the 11th commandment, not to make a disparaging or to a condescending statement about a fellow Republican, that's out the door. But then again, it doesn't apply to Richard Irvin. Obviously, he's willing to make these statements.
The commandment, I don't think, applies to him because he's not a Republican. He's a registered Democrat. Voting as a Democrat as recently as 2021, as you were showing me.
Well, and this first one, I'm going to take this one right off the top of the stack that I put in front of Nate. It says that a deceiver and liar. Now, he has two pictures. He has one of Darren Bailey, and he has another of Jesse Sullivan. And, you know, we've had Jesse Sullivan in studio. We've made an invitation to the other candidates, Paul Schimpf, Gary Rabine, Max Solomon, and Richard Irvin. Obviously, Richard Irvin's campaign has never gotten back with us, but he has two candidates that he seems to be taking target at. It started out as just one, but he states about Darren Bailey, voted Obama into office. It's not even possible. What does he mean by that? Well, you look at his little sourced and you go down to the bottom of the flyer and it says, number one, Aurora Mayor Richard Irvin announces Republican bid for governor in a tough on crime message, Chicago Tribune. Wait a minute. How can you reference your announcement as being the proof that he voted for Obama into office?
You know, it's a deceptive campaign when the source you're citing is yourself.
Is yourself. You are the source.
Trust me. Look at my announcement speech.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's how I know.
Trust me. Well, and you know, Nate, fortunately, it was good to have Nate visiting us at the Tabernacle today with Pastor Tim Farrell. Gave a powerful message about money, managing money, because that's what this is about, right? You can take money. $45 million, and you can dump $11 million into a campaign of trying to scorched earth, right, on your fellow competitor, Darren Bailey, who's the furthest from any of the things, or Jesse Sullivan. I've met Jesse Sullivan. Jesse Sullivan is not what he's portraying Jesse to be either, but specifically Darren, because Darren was the front runner in the Republican Party before Richard Irvin got into the game,
right,
which happened to be just in January when you could poll petitions and actually start circulating them. But, you know, at church today, he gave this message about sowing and reaping. You know, there's a lot going on in sowing in this wonderful land that we live in, the land of Lincoln, which is some of the richest farm ground in the world.
I believe McLean County has some of the richest soil, like, in the world, like, specifically in this county.
And there's a little side note to that, because it comes from my college days of understanding a little bit about geology. So when the Ice Age came along, because there's a reason we have Moraine State View Park right out here.
Oh, yeah.
And it has to do with that's where the Ice Age or the glaciers came. And as they receded and created the Great Lakes, obviously, and some of the other beautiful areas of Illinois, like Galena, they deposited this very rich soil behind. There's a name for it. It is uranium-rich soil, too, which is interesting. That's where we get radon levels. You probably have heard about that. If you're a homeowner, you've heard about radon levels. But ultimately, it's a great state. That's the key. And there's so much for it. So these farmers are planning. And what they expect come the fall is to get the combine out and to reap it. Well, Richard Irvin is also sowing. He's sowing deception. It's fascinating that he can call his opponent a deceiver or a liar when the first thing on any of these brochures, I think one of them has something to do with Here it is. Darren Bailey, WCIA, Mark Maxwell. If you don't know about Mark Maxwell at WCIA, Mark Maxwell is an anti-Trumper and an anti-Bailey person. So we're going to source Mark Maxwell, who is actually verbally accosted Darren Bailey's wife, Cindy. And he was told that they would no longer entertain any interviews with him. Because of his behavior. You have to act like a professional, Mark. Yes, you heard it here, Mark. Anytime, call me up. Love to have a talk with you. But anyhow, on this particular brochure, it says Darren Bailey breaks with Trump. That's a mailer in your mailbox. It says Darren Bailey breaks with Trump. Darren Bailey was just at Mar-a-Lago. He has pictures out there with Cindy Bailey. It's a fascinating story. He was there for Mary Miller for a fundraising event at Mar-a-Lago. He and Darren had an opportunity to chat, take pictures together. I don't know. I'm hopeful. I think many people are that he will endorse Darren.
Looks like it. I mean, I would assume so. I don't know what the timetable is on that. I guess there's a little bit of time. Primaries in June.
June 28th.
So
he just came out and did an endorsement of what governor did he, governor candidate did he just endorse? I can't remember the state. I'm going to have to look that up. We'll get back with you. But there was an announcement on Truth Social that he was going to be making another endorsement. He's going to continue to endorse. In fact, there will be people getting endorsements the week before the election.
Trump's running the table on endorsements.
Oh, yeah.
He's, you know.
50-0 right now.
Oh, yeah. It's the Pennsylvania primary coming up, I think, this week is going to be interesting to see that unfold. But, yeah, I think I bet you he does endorse Darren. And I think it's going to happen.
Well, here's some inside baseball from DPB on the DPB show at Cities 92.9, the news and talk of Bloomington Normal. If you're just joining us, yes, this has gotten to be enough. I can't take it any longer. The deception, the man calling everybody a deceiver is himself a deceiver. He's a liar. He is a bona fide registered Democrat who's infiltrated the Republican Party. Our party needs to stop it. The nonsense has got to stop. It's all about money. It's been about money. I encourage you to go out and research this guy. But more specifically, this is what we're going to talk about today. I don't even know what to say. Getting back to Darren. Darren told me a story, and I know that I'm more than he's given me permission to share this. But when he got a photo shoot with the president, Donald Trump, Donald actually walked up to the cameraman, his photographer, and said, "Hey, let me look at the pictures." And he started swiping through them. And he goes, "This is a keeper." So the former president goes up to his photographer during a photo shoot with Darren, Mary Miller, Chris Miller, Cindy Bailey, and he wants to look at the camera. And he said, "This is the one." He points to a picture. He goes, "Darren, if an endorsement from me is going to come, I want to make sure that I have a good picture of you and I."
Already has it picked out. So what does that tell you?
Exactly. Well, I think that one of the other better stories that I like is the fact that Darren is at dinner. The president himself is kind of quadrant off, which you get it, right? Yeah. So he's not bothered during dinner. He's got many guests there at Mar-a-Lago. But Darren's walking by and he says, "Hey, Darren." And Darren turns around and he goes, hey, president. He goes, "Thanks all for everything you've done for Mary Miller, you know, running for Congress." He's already endorsed her. He said, "Darren, you like the music?" And Darren's like, "What? Do I like the music?" And the president goes, "Yeah, what do you want to hear?" And Darren's like kind of perplexed. He's like, "Okay." And he goes, and he pulls out his phone. And he points to it. He goes, "I'm the DJ." So the president himself in Mar-a-Lago is running he's the DJ. He's running the music.
Just when I thought I couldn't like Trump more, that is luck. Cause I'm that guy. I love controlling the music at an event. I'll pull my phone out and so, I love that.
Well, we were kind of off air. We were talking about that because Tony, who's just across the way, we had a remote for the bowl for tailgate and tall boys. And we were in an establishment. We were talking about the music selection and I was trying to control it as the DJ and wasn't having a lot of success with that. But if I had the button, I would have controlled it. But that's what this is about, right? This is control, controlling the message, controlling where we go from here. But ultimately, this is a guy named Mike Z. He's a political consultant, lives in Nashville, Tennessee. I don't know what he's reaping, probably well over $1 million from the Irvin Bourne campaign for governor, but he's the one putting this forth. So this is important that we understand this. I know you're tired of it. I'm tired of it. We need to call this out. And we're going to continue to do that today here at the DPB Show on Cities 92.9. Hey, join us after break. We've got many more flyers to cover.
Cities 92.9.
Yes, you're here at Cities 92.9, the news and talk of Bloomington Normal. I'm David Paul Blumenshine. This is the DPB show. And if you want to be part of the show, which I love it when you text in, whether it's good, bad, or ugly, text her in to 309-451-9299, 309-451-9299. That is also our studio line. Feel free to call today. We are do not have a lot of traffic as far as callers when it comes to having guests on the show. Most of the guests that we're going to have are in studio today, like our very own Nate Byrne, who likes to join me here from time to time. I'm hoping that it becomes more frequent, but you know what? He's a working man like all of us. He's trying to pay for that, the Joe Biden inflation.
Yeah, it's been tough, you know, just like I imagine a lot of people in this community are hurting. A lot of people all over the country are hurting because of these policies and this inflation and economy. So I hope to be here regularly.
Well,
I hope to.
We want to get you here regularly. Speaking of regularly, we have a caller on the line who has called in today. He wants to talk a little bit about what we're discussing in regards to Richard Irvin. Scott, are you there? Scott, can you hear me?
I can hear you.
All right, Scott. How are you?
I'm doing all right.
What do you think of all this craziness with Richard Irvin and these mailers?
Well, Irvin's kind of a ticket there. I've met him in person, and he's loud and brash just in person. It's not an act for him. He's that way all the time.
So so has he been filling your mailbox up too, Scott?
He is. He has been filling my mailbox up. I was calling in about Bailey.
Well, that's fine. Keep going. I love to talk about Darren Bailey. I think all of my audience knows that.
Yeah, no, I've dismissed Irvin, even though I think he's probably got the financing, but he is a hollow candidate. Bailey, I was a big Bailey supporter when he first announced, and then he came up to Stephanie Trussell.
Yeah.
My God, you gotta have a big ship to drag that anchor around.
So why do you think that Stephanie Trussell is an anchor?
Because early on when Trump was running for president, she came out against him, and she came out against everybody that supported him. And all those people are the people who are going to support Bailey.
So you know that that's not true, right? As far as, yes, when she had her talk show, she didn't think Trump was conservative enough. But she ended up being in the White House with Trump, kind of like Darren being in Mar-a-Lago with Trump.
Yeah.
Did you realize that?
No, I don't realize that.
Okay, so you know what, Scott? I know we're up against a break, so I'll give it to you real quick. Go out and look at the website. Go out to Stephanie Trussell's personal Facebook page. She was on WLS as a conservative talk show host, as a mama bear. She didn't think Trump was conservative enough. You know what? A lot of us didn't. A lot of us were going for Cruz. We're going for Rubio. We didn't know who this guy was who was whining and dining the best of the best in New York City, especially New York City Democrats. So that's what she said. She came out and said, I was wrong. She ended up going and voting for him in 2016, being part of his the Trump train in 2020. She came out, was with the president at the White House. So sorry, Scott, I didn't mean to rain on your parade. I'm glad, no, though, that you called in.
You're fine. He needs to put that in his mailer.
He has it. Yeah, he will. And wait till what you see here coming from the Bailey campaign. They just got some financing, and we're going to talk about that when we come back from break. Hey, Scott, appreciate you. Thank you. Spread the word, Scott. Spread the word. That's what it takes. One thing, spread the word. Hey, we're going to be back after break here at Cities 92.9, the news and talk of Bloomington Normal.
If I had only known the last time would be the last time, I would have put off all the things I had to do. I would have stayed a little longer, held on a little tighter.
Wow, that song gets me. I hope it gets you, because it's such a great reminder of how valuable our time is on this earth with the ones we love, and how we manifest ourselves on a day-in, day-out basis. We truly do reap what we sow. And that was the topic. If you're just coming on online today at Cities 92.9, the news and talk of Bloomington Normal, I'm David Paul Blumenschein. This is the DPB Show. In studio with me is my friend, Nate Byrne. He is somebody that I lean into a lot for these political discussions. And this one that we're talking about today is sowing, reaping what you sow. And especially when it comes to the Republican Party, as we approach this June 28th primary, the deception that is out there, even with the last caller, Scott, I so appreciate you listening as an audience. And I know it's easy to throw out Stephanie Trussell's an anchor to Darren Bailey. The gal, go look at her testimony. Go look at who she was. She has been a staunch conservative. The thing that we need to be focusing on, Scott, isn't the money. You want to talk about the money of Richard Irvin? I just pulled it up. Nate, what'd you think? You go to IllinoisSunshine.org. That's IllinoisSunshine.org. You put in the campaign of Irvin for Illinois. You can look at the money. He just had a drop of $25 million from the richest man in Illinois, Ken Griffith, into his account on May 2nd. His total war chest right now stands at $36,136,000. It's not about the money. He is buying votes. He bought signatures when his circulators were circulating his petitions to get on the ballot. This is so infiltrated by the Democrat Party. And then you scroll down and you actually look at his expenses. It's the top 25 expenses or the all expenditures. There are no expenditures found because there is a little thing, gamesmanship, you can play. You can defer paying people in campaigns if you've got the money. Therefore, you really don't have to report it until you pay for it. You can have an invoice. I don't know if there's other sources. I know there are other sources. I'm going to go and do a little deep dive on that just to see what this man has paid for. He's paid for Mikey Z, who is his political consultant down in Nashville, who's really the brainchild behind this smear campaign on Darren Bailey and Jesse Sullivan. But I want to know about you, Richard. We want to know about you. Anytime you want to come, I saw you were at Keg Grove. I don't mean to throw out a cheap plug for Keg Grove. I do like your beer. It'd be great if you guys advertised on the DPB show. But I did see that Richard Irvin was at Keg Grove with Avery Bourne. Were any of you aware of that on Friday? No?
I have no idea.
No. Richard Irvin was in town. He can't make a forum. He won't take questions. The last interview that he actually did was you talk about a train wreck, a dumpster fire on wheels. I mean, it was pathetic. But getting back to these mailers, what did you see viewing them? I mean, Nate, you've got insight to this stuff. You guys have sent mailers out for different campaigns.
I mean, I'll tell you what, at this campaign, it's kind of like, it looks like a very expensive, shiny cardboard cutout of a campaign. it's kind of a thin veneer of, I was telling DPB that I have never been so inundated with a TV ad as Richard Irvin's TV ads, and particularly some of the DGA Pritzker ads, which Pritzker money. Running against Irvin, it's like he's set up as a prop and as a useful tool for the Democrats. And it's interesting. I mean, all you have to do is, you showed me that ad. All you have to do is look at the ads that Pritzker's running.
Well, and the one you're referring to from the Democratic Governors Association,
which was
released. It's a minute and 4 seconds. It was released 2 days after Richard Irvin announced he was running for governor, which obviously Darren Bailey announced back in February 2021. And he went to work just like he's been doing since day one when he was sworn into the General Assembly. And we all know the gamesmanship that goes under Mike Madigan. Now Mike Madigan's out of the way. We got our own problem with Jim Durkin. Not a fan. Jim Durkin obviously has already come out and endorsed Richard Irvin. But this particular video was put out 2 days after he announced from the Democratic Governors Association of America, Richard Irvin, big fan of J.B. Pritzker. All it shows is how enamored Richard Irvin was with Pritzker. So then you start playing the ops, you know, in your mind. Why is it that does JB truly want to run against Darren Bailey? Does he want to exhaust the limited funding? Even though Darren Bailey, go out to IllinoisSunshine.org, look Bailey for Illinois. He just got a drop of $2.5 million. Darren has always contended. The Bailey campaign has always contended. About $5 million is what we need to have in our coffers. And when I say we, you're right. You caught me. I've had Darren on my show for the last year and a half. I think you know where I stand. And that's part of coming on this show today, because I couldn't stand it anymore looking at these mailers, hearing his commercials.
But you're also open to having other candidates on.
Yeah.
That's a key thing. That's, you know, you are open to the discussion. It's like, prove me wrong.
Yeah. I'd love Richard Irvin. Instead of going to see Jeff at Keg Grove and sipping back a pint, hey, Richard, you know what? I'd be more than happy to go on the road and go mobile with our show at Keg Grove with you, one-on-one, and we can have some discussions of questions that you refuse to answer. I want to hear it from your lips. I will bring all of these nice stack of, flyers, which I do have to give kudos to Stephanie Trussell when she was in front of Avery Bourne.
I saw
and she
that.
Was,
I was
fanning herself
that.
With Fan, these.
With She had them fanned out and while Avery Bourne was speaking.
Yeah, yeah, she obviously caught Avery Bourne herself was confused at that point, because here she has another lieutenant governor candidate fanning herself with this garbage that you've put in the mail, which, like I said, you reap what you sow. What is he doing to the Republican Party, Nate? Because how can the Republican Party truly recover after having a candidate who's not a Republican infiltrate the party? Of course, those in positions of authority right now, like a Jim Durkin or a Ryan Spain, or, you know, the list goes on, and Avery Bourne, as Avery Bourne had a minority leader position, deputy minority leader position, similar to our very own Dan Brady from, right. And you know, interesting factoid, and this is what I'm saying, how does he recover? Because Dan Brady gave hundreds of thousands of dollars to the House Republican organization, which is now named the House Republican Majority. And there's only one reason for that, because Jim Durkin narrowly escaped being booted from the leadership position of the minority, which in of itself is nothing to brag about, because 73 Democrats on the Democratic side, 45 Republicans in the House. In the Senate, it's not too much better. It's 41 Democrat senators and 18 Republican senators. But how does a Dan Brady or any of us, Dan gave all that money to the House Republican organization and decided to run for a statewide office. And as soon as he did, they threw him to the curb.
The politics is brutal. It's a blood sport. Even inter-party squabbles. And it's, as we're seeing here, you know, I used to be of the persuasion of some, I used to be an Illinois Republican, grew up here my whole life. But I used to be someone who would have gone for a Richard Irvin type candidate. I used to be someone who would have gone for a Durkin candidate, a Dan Brady candidate. And I think back to when Reagan, I believe in the 70s, before he was president, was speaking at CPAC. And the famous line of, we need bold colors, not pale pastels. Mm. And in Illinois, I used to think, well, you got to kind of hedge and hem and haw. And if you want to be a successful Republican running for statewide office, well, you know, you got to kind of go along to get along. It's a hard state. It's difficult terrain. And I'm not denying that there are political realities that Republicans have to pay attention to in a state like Illinois. It's a very blue state with lots of red in it. But
it wasn't always that way.
It wasn't always that way. Yeah. Right. And demographics change, political geography changes. But I just think you need to be bold. I have got reached that point where it's like you have to offer a stark contrast.
Well, if we're going to reform Springfield and restore Illinois and get away from this blue abyss is what we've lived in, because they've created one of the most it's one of the most irresponsible mismanagement of money for almost two decades. How do you recover? Getting back to recovering, and I want to get this in before we go to the break. Kudos to county chair, GOP county chair from McLean County. I wish more county chairs across the state, 102 county chairs out there for the GOP, like Connie Beard. shout out to Connie Beer. This came from her 3 days ago. It is very discouraging when candidates resort to distortions and lies to win votes. It's even more discouraging when they wear the label Republican. The current campaign tactics, and she did, I like that, preface that by saying, wear the label. They don't necessarily identify or have it as part of who their character, who they are. The current campaign tactics used by the Irvin campaign exceeds normal, tough campaign tactics. Referring to what you said, it's a blood sport. We don't expect it from our own party members. But then again, as we discussed earlier, Richard Irvin is not part of the Republican Party. He is a fake Republican. He is a registered Democrat. For those of us who know these men, referring to Jesse Sullivan and Darren Bailey, because they're the two that are obviously highlighted. And now we know after the WGN polling, this is really only a two-person race. It's between Darren Bailey. The margin of error is about 2 to 3%, depending on who you believe. Either Bailey's up by 2 or Irvin's up by 2. It's too close to call. But this is where the work is going to get done. Jesse is going to, for whatever reason, I don't know if he's trying to get Jesse to come in and back him. I hope that doesn't happen. You never know.
A lot of money there.
A lot of money. Jesse's got about $11 million. Combined, those guys have spent well over $20 million on advertising. Jesse, you know, and shout out to Jesse for not involving himself in this type of politics. But for those of us who know these men, it is hard to see them so totally misrepresented. The bylaws of the McLean County Republican Party do not allow me to endorse in a contest or contested primary. Rightly so, as our role as a party should be to allow our Republican voters to have access to all candidates to let them make the decision at the primary. But I cannot stay silent when such mailers as these pile up in our mailboxes. She has a picture in at the GOP website, so go to the McLean County Republican Facebook page. But I cannot stay silent as these pile up. Having a large war chest of campaign funds does not mean it needs to be used in such fashion. I urge voters to not listen to mailings, mass mailings, but to learn for yourselves who these people are and asking for your vote. You know what? I encourage you to go do your research. Call me here at Cities 92.9. Talk it over with me. You can do that after the break. When we come back, I hope you join us here on the DPB Show. You know, the fact that we even have to mention that here at Cities 92.9, the news and talk of Bloomington Normal, is basically an abomination that you have to fund an organization like Team Blue Line, which is my friend David Quinn, who hosts a run out at Tipton Trails every Tuesday night in honor of our fallen men in blue. But the fact that we'd even have to stop senseless killings of law enforcement, it goes to show you the climate that we live in. And you know what? It can be changed. Anything can be changed in the course of 2 years. And that's what we're hopeful to be able to achieve. That's what we're talking about here today. If you're just joining us at Cities 92.9, the news and talk of Bloomington Normal on the DPB Show, we'd love for you to chime in at 309-451-9299. But it is the deception, the lies. You have a candidate running for governor under the Republican Party, who is not a registered Republican, a registered Democrat, who is overfunded by the richest man in Illinois, and has opened up this campaign of deception as he calls his opponents deceivers and liars, Nate.
And it's not just that, it's not as if he was a Democrat years ago and had, you know, kind of converted over, had a change of heart. He's a Democrat like now, like registered on the books, voting as recently on the record as 2021 as a Democrat.
Yeah, in fact, the official record is, and we've put this up on our Facebook page, it's from Kane County. It says the state of Illinois, Kane County, from the John Cunningham, who is still, believe it or not, John is 84 years of age as their county clerk. When you see a picture of him, you think he looks like he's 68. He looks that young. So obviously this keeps him going. I know his wife had passed away, and it's something that he does. But he sounds like he's a pretty good county clerk in Kane County. Happens to be the county that Richard Irvin resides in.
Right.
But this is John Cunningham shares this, that, you know, it's Richard Cardell is his middle name. If you didn't know, Richard, he doesn't put that on his mailers. He just says Irvin for Illinois. But registered party Democrat. Voter status active in in February of 2023 during the consolidated election. He pulled a Democrat ballot in March of 2020 in the primary, pulled the Democrat ballot. He has pulled one Republican ballot in the last seven election cycles. That was in 2018. He pulled in the general primary, pulled a Republican ballot, but 2017 Democratic ballot, that's when he was running for mayor. Obviously must have run as a Democrat because he wanted to vote for himself, I guess. The general primary of 2016, Democrat, 2014, Democrat. Now you can see, it's out there, there's text messages of him calling Trump a racist and an idiot, and the fact that he doesn't like the man. That now has blown up. So for all of his effort to try to expose others for for being anti-Trumpers, it now comes out because everything about his campaign is a lie. It's a lie. I don't know how to get people to realize that anytime you have somebody that's willing to put forth a $20 million spend to try to tell you everything bad about his competition, rather than to tell you about his achievements and his vision and his leadership of bringing Illinois out of this abyss of financial mismanagement, morally and fiscally. I mean, we've got so many issues in Illinois, Nate, that he could be addressing, and instead, he's filling our mailboxes up. Well, there we go. Tony was quick. We've got to go to break again. We are going to come back after break. We have a state representative candidate that's in studio. We're going to get his thoughts on kind of what we've been talking about and going forward, running a campaign as a conservative Republican right here in our local marketplace. Hey, stay tuned. Come back. We look forward to it on the other side of the break.
It's the DPB Show.
Yes, it is. It is the DPB Show, coming to you every Sunday live in the Twin Cities, Bloomington Normal, at Cities 92.9, the news and talk of Bloomington Normal. Not only can you reach us here live on the radio, but you can stream us anytime, anywhere, at cities929.com. And if you want to be part of the show, which I always am very willing to hear anybody's opinion, good, bad, or the ugly, you can text us at 309-451-9299, or you can call in at 309-451-9299. And I'm going to defer getting to our guest, our next guest, candidate for state representative of the 91st District, James Fisher, to take a caller. We have one on the line. Caller, are you there?
I'm here.
Oh, caller, I know who this is.
David?
George, how are you?
Oh, I'm just fine, David. Haven't talked in quite a while, buddy.
George, you know, it's been crazy. It's been busy. I've got to talk to our general manager about getting you your own show, because I think you need to have the city's George show.
I think so, too.
How can we arrange that?
I don't know, but I've got, there's one word, David, and I need a couple of minutes here, but one word is destroy.
Okay, so how many minutes do I have to give you? Because this is my show.
Okay, say five.
Okay. Five? Wait, whoa, George. I've got three. I'm going to give you three. Okay, go. You've got it. You're on the clock.
One word is destroy the whole world. You got kids, David?
I sure do. I've got two daughters that just turned 24.
Did you raise them to be independent?
Yes, I did.
To be independent?
Yes.
Can they cook, clean, do their own laundry and everything else?
Yes.
Well, they're not independent, David. The word independent, the old Webster Dictionary says self-governing. That's all it says, self-governing. You did a heck of a job. You did better than you thought. You made your children self-sufficient. They can go on through life because of what you taught them. They can teach their kids. Independent kid in Bloomington at Walmart. I'm independent. I says, young man, you're independent? He says, yeah. Puts his chest out. I said, about 18, yeah. So what you're telling me is you got a job, your own home. I got to talk fast. Or at least an apartment. No, I don't have any of that. So you still live at home. You pay no rent. That's right. I see you got a cell phone in your back pocket. Who bought that? Mom. Who pays the bill? Mom. Got a car? Mom. Okay. You work around the house, though. Your dad pays the insurance. Yeah. So you work around the house. You rake the leaves, cut the grass, all that. No, I don't do any of that. No scraping the paint. No, I don't do any of that either. So you work in the house, keep your room clean, do everything you have to do, make your own bed, cook your own food, do your own laundry, right? That's the big one. No, I don't do any of that either. So would you call that kid independent? Because he's living, and Mom, I need $20. She gives it to him.
No, he's not independent.
Yes, he is. The Webster Dictionary says self-governing. This kid comes and goes as he wants, but he is dependent. But he's not he is independent.
He's dependent. Interdependent or dependent?
He's both. He's independent. He's depending on Mom and Dad for everything. And he's independent because the Webster Dictionary says he comes and goes and does what he wants. Every shooting in every school, these kids are all loners. That's just another word. Too independent. Why do we think we got 70 million abortions? Because dads aren't home to take care of their daughters, to educate them, to treat them, to wash them, watch for them and everything else.
And that's that is a very powerful point. And you do bring that up often, Cities, George. And I think you could parlay this into your own show. George, real quick, because I'm up against having another guest and getting through some other material. Have you been receiving these mailers from Richard Irvin in your mailbox?
You know what? My mailbox, my garbage can is right by the mailbox.
It's about, what do they say? These flyers have about a life of about 15 seconds or something.
They don't even get,
it's a second mailbox
anymore.
Yeah.
I've got one of each for everybody that's running, but we have no Republicans that's got balls today. This guy shouldn't even be on the ticket.
Hey,
anybody can see.
Hey, wait a second. There are good candidates in the Republican Party right now. They're usually the ones who aren't getting bought and paid for by the establishment. You know, Darren Bailey's a good candidate. Gary Rabine, I think, is a good candidate. Max Solomon, Paul Schimpf, I think, is a real good guy. I wanted to get him on my show, George, but unfortunately, Paul's got standards. He's got morals. He's got values. He won't do a show on a Sunday, so I'd have to actually do a tape. So I'm trying to still work on getting Paul on tape with Gary Rabine. Those guys are busy because they're up against this cartel. What is the other oligarchy? That's what it is. It's really an oligarchy that they're up against. So they have to work almost twice or 10 times as hard. I know Darren Bailey's out there working every day. Hey, George, I do appreciate you. And I'm sorry it's been a kind of a long time. Can you call back in next week? I want to continue this.
Back in. If you'll take my call, I would promise I would call back.
I will take your call, George, and I'm going to work in the next week on trying to get the city's George 5-minute segment every Sunday.
Hey, no matter what you want to talk about, why won't this guy come in on Sunday?
Oh, you mean Paul Schimpf?
Right.
Because he's got two young boys, and he tries to be around his household. You know, you're just talking about a father in the household, right?
That's a good man. Today, if there's a father in there, there's nobody there. Why? And another thing, and I will get out of your hair, is why do we have so much homosexuality in our country today? People need to look up the Georgia Guidestones. All the Democrats are trying to do is eliminate population. I will do a special on that for you next week.
I'd love to hear a 5-minute special on that, on the depopulation through same-sex attraction, according to Cities George. Can't wait. It's going to be a big
same-sex
one. Hey, George. Go ahead.
He has kids.
Hey, and there's some validity to what you're saying. Hey, George, I do appreciate you calling in here. We're going to get to our next guest here, but thank you for calling in. And with that, I do want to definitely welcome James Fisher, who is running for state representative of the 91st District. He's in studio with us. James, welcome. It's been too long to get you here, but you're here now.
Thank you very much for having me, Dave.
And sorry about that with Cities George.
Oh, that's perfectly okay.
He's just part of the show.
I was smiling listening to him.
he's definitely opinionated, and once again, that's what the First Amendment affords us, right?
Yes,
Second Amendment affords us the right to bear arms. The Constitution affords us life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. You have chosen to run for the 91st state representative seat. It's an open seat because of the newly drawn maps. Tell us how it's going so far.
Well, so far, I think it's going great. It really is. I have lived in the district. I've lived here for, it's going to be 37 years. This is May, right?
Yes,
May 1985 that I moved here.
1985, okay.
And I live in a small farm west of Hudson. I've lived there. I've raised two daughters. They have now, they've grown up, married, and we even have some grandchildren now.
So how many grandchildren do you have, James?
Two granddaughters.
All right. That's the best when you have grandchildren.
So when the district became available, there were some people that said, I'm going to run. You're going to run for that. And I said, well, you're going to run for that, aren't you? Okay, yes, I will. So
is this the first time you've actually run for public office?
I was on the Unit 5 school board.
Okay.
That has been a while ago. It was back in the early 90s that I was on a school board in District
Unit. And how long did you serve on the school board?
I served 4 years, one term there.
And the school board today versus the school board back then? Yeah. Can we even cover that? That takes a whole nother show. Yes. Hey, you mentioned something, Jim, and I'm going to call you Jim rather than James. Do you mind if I do that?
Please do.
You said that you live in district. Your opponent does not live in district. He's one of these, what they call carpetbaggers, right?
Well, my understanding is he does not live in the district. That's correct.
Okay. So you have an opponent that doesn't live in district, so that means he can't even vote for himself in the primary. So that at least means you get one more vote than he does right now.
There we go.
Because I'm assuming you're going to vote for yourself.
Absolutely.
And your wife's going to vote for you.
Yeah, she said that. She said she would. Yes.
So it's always good to know that your wife, and that's a shout out to my wife, because I know that she voted for me twice when I ran for state rep of the 105th district.
Yes.
Yeah, so at least I know there were two votes. I voted for myself, and then I have a daughter, two daughters that actually live in the district and some other family members. But that's the good old-fashioned way of winning elections. You do it through the grassroots, through friends and family, and getting out your message out rather than looking for the establishment to come in, swoop down, and drop millions of dollars into your campaign. Nobody's done that for you yet, have they, Jim?
No, they haven't.
If people would like to give your campaign some money, where could they do that at?
They can get on our website, which is James Fisher 91st at gmail.com.
Okay.
And there's a place there where you can make a donation, or it also gives the address if you wanted to just send a check to the mail for Fisher for 91st, and it's Post Office Box 91. Hudson, Illinois.
And I'm going to put that up. Tony, we're going to get that up on our Facebook page, because obviously we want to help encourage as many grassroots candidates, especially somebody like yourself. You didn't have the money to pay for anyone to circulate your petitions, right?
That's correct.
How many signatures did you end up getting in order to be on the ballot?
I had over 500 signatures.
Okay.
I requested 400, but I think it was 580 or something like that. But
so you got enough signatures from going door to door and going to different events.
Freezing the toes off in February, my goodness.
Which was calculated, right? Because it used to be that we would circulate from September until the first week of December, which for the most part, it was fairly mild weather.
That's
now the sun started setting a little earlier when we had that other circulating period. But now it's the dead of winter.
I kind of wondered about that. When they moved those things back to June for the primary election, and then we had to circulate the petitions in February, I go, oh my goodness, it's cold out here.
Well, you are a self-professed Christian conservative Republican.
Yes.
Is that true? Is that accurate to describe
Absolutely.
You?
Yes, it is.
Okay.
Yes, it is.
Tell us about what are the top three things that you see you face going into this, the belly of the beast is what I call Sangamon County in Springfield, because if ever there was a place where there's more depravity and underhandedness. I mean, and for those of you that are shocked by me saying that, come on, I just have to say Michael Madigan. There you go. But what are the three things you believe need to be brought out during your campaign that we need to start working on?
Only three?
Well, I'm like cities, George. I can only give you so much time today before I have to go back to ranting and raving.
Taxes, taxes, taxes. There's three right there.
Taxes, taxes, taxes.
We are taxed on where we live. We tax on to put fuel in my car.
Yeah.
We are taxed on the income that I make, no matter how much it is, a little or a lot. I still taxed on that. The the taxes that we have to pay for fuel, Illinois is one of the highest.
Yes. The highest, actually.
At the same time, we are also one of the highest as far as the poorest conditions of our roads.
And it's cumulative tax. I mean, we as a state are always at the, you know, we at least we're number one in something, meaning obviously taxing our citizens of Illinois.
Right, and part of that tax is also one of the reasons why we're number one in people leaving the state.
And we are. For out-migration, obviously, we've almost lost 1 million people in the last decade, which they haven't figured out a solution to. They say that that's just based on weather, because people want to go where it's nicer. I don't begrudge anybody, but I kind of like to see the wide open spaces, the fields, especially during the planting season. We opened up the show talking about sowing and reaping. Right. And obviously, as a farmer, you understand, if you don't sow, you will not be able to reap. And the tax thing, Nate and I actually were in service this morning, and the pastor talked about taxation is biblical. Jesus paid taxes. Mm-hmm. We control how much tax is that we are put under and how many, because like you said, we need a certain amount of taxation, right?
Yes.
To make government work.
And the basic form is right when you're talking about the Board of Education, and they're the basic form. They're probably your very smallest form of government.
Mm-hmm.
And they're the ones that are determining a taxation for running the schools, which is fine. But it's also very important that we have good people running for that, for the board.
For the school boards.
Absolutely.
And obviously that's pronounced right now, and we come into 2023, those positions will be up for re-election in the school boards. And after the year they've had, you're going to have to be somebody that really is determined to be on a school board. There is a lot going on out there. School boards weren't meant to be just a rubber stamp for the teachers' unions. And once again, I'm not down on the teachers' unions. You guys know my wife's 33 years, District 87, as a school teacher. I fully support teachers. I do support organized labor. What I don't support is when the organized labor, the bosses of those organized labors, are in cahoots with Michael Madigan, J.B. Pritzker, and they're driving basically people out of the industry. Look at trying to get teachers, you know, that's a big thing. That's what they're going to face in the funding. Hey, Jim, when we come back, I want to talk a little bit more about your farming background, because there's another farmer that I know that you are willing to actually publicly come out and endorse today. When we come back from break, I'm not going to share who it is you're endorsing for governor. You might have a totally different answer than what I think you're having. But hey, we're going to do that here at Cities 92.9, the news and talk of Bloomington Normal. Come back after the break. I still will have Jim in studio with us.
Cities 92.9.
I don't need to recognize the man in the mirror. I don't want to trade your plans for something familiar. I can't waste a day, and I can't stay the same. I want to be different. I want to be changed.
You know, you actually would be hopeful that everyone would like to stand in the mirror and say to themselves, I've done the best I can. I've been honest with people, forthright. I've truly tried to sow goodness, kindness, graciousness, love into others. And that's what we're not seeing, unfortunately, in this campaign that is in front of us. June 28th is the primary. You need to get out and vote. I know your mailbox has been full. Nate's going to be back with me here after the bottom of the hour, and we're going to kind of break that down a little bit more. But right now in studio, we have Jim Fisher, known as James Fisher on his big 4x4 signs, running for state representative of the 91st District. And if you're wondering what the 91st District is, I'm going to give you a little bit of a tutorial. They've mapped this thing to be mostly Bloomington Normal, central Bloomington Normal, so to the west of Veterans Parkway. It goes to the north a little bit, not too far. Jim, how far north does it go?
It goes up Interstate 39.
Okay.
It goes to El Paso.
Okay.
But it meets up with 24 there and
yep.
goes west, clear over to East Peoria. But it's interesting
how... But Metamora, it it goes around Metamore, right?
Oh, it goes around all the small towns.
It goes around all the conservative base.
Well, you would think so. If you look at the map, how they surgically went around the town of Eureka and then back up to 24 over to Washington. And then it went to downtown Washington, and then it goes drops again to get around some of the parts of Washington.
Basically gerrymandered, drawn in order to make sure that they can have a fair shot at it. They'd love to have two state representatives from the Democrat Party in the 46th state Senate seat. That's each Senate seat, there's 59 of them in Illinois, have two representative districts. That totals 118. Jim is one of them. That's his district. It has a little bit of East Peoria, Bartonville area. Obviously goes across 74.
74 back to Bloomington Normal. It comes down 150, goes over to where the Rivian is, down to Route 9, and then back into Bloomington Normal.
Okay, so real quick, Jim, we talked about it before we went to break. You're a farmer. There's another farmer running for the governor's position. Are you willing to endorse him?
Well, let's see. There was a guy, I think he says he does some farming, and I've seen him at one of the rallies, and I think one of the first things he said something about, when I'm elected governor, I will repeal the Illinois FOID card. You had my attention, right?
He had your attention. Actually, Jim, I've been at those events. I think you've been at more than just one rally. Jim is one of the frequent flyers, and I know you support that candidate, and his name is
Darren Bailey.
Jim Fisher is officially endorsed Darren Bailey for governor of Illinois, and Jim is running for the 91st district state representative seat in the 91st district. Jim, how can the people get a hold of you in order to become part of your campaign?
I have a website, jamesfisher91st@gmail.com, and I also have an email, which says jamesfisher91st@gmail. And then there's a Facebook page, I believe it says Jim Fisher - Freedom for the 91st.
Well, there you have it. We will put that stuff on our Facebook page for Jim. Jim, I appreciate you coming into studio today. Obviously, you've got a lot of work to do. The time is short. You're under 60 days. So what, 50 days now until the primary?
6 weeks, yes.
I want the listeners to know that Jim is available. You can reach him at his Facebook page. Get in touch with him. He needs your help to make sure that he goes to Springfield.
That's correct. And when I get to Springfield and when Darren Bailey is our governor, there's a lot we can do.
There is a lot you can do. Hey, I so appreciate you joining us here today at Cities 92.9, the news and talk of Bloomington Normal. We're going to be back, and we're going to continue to break this down about sowing and reaping in politics. Hey, join us on the other side of break.
Why you ever chose me has always been a mystery. All my life, I've been told I belong at the end of the line with all the other not quite. We'll all never get it right, but it turns out they're the ones you were looking for all this time. 'Cause I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody all about somebody.
Gosh, that sums it up. Here at Cities 92.9, the news and talk of Bloomington Normal. I'm David Paul Blumenschein. It is the DPB Show. And you know, when I say it, it really sums it up. I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody about somebody. You know, you might feel the same way. And, you know, I've been involved in politics long enough. I know you have, Nate. We have Nate Byrne back in studio with us. He's not only a friend, but he's somebody that I followed on social media. He's always good. He has great insight to the political landscape. And that's why I always really nurture his time. And he's with us today, so I want to give him as much time as I can. But these mailers, you know, the amount of people that believe this is what my wife and I and other people within in the campaign, the Bailey campaign, we're shaking our heads going, people keep asking us questions. Is it really true that Darren raised taxes 81%? First and foremost, Darren has never voted to raise a tax in the General Assembly of Illinois. What they're alluding to is this, Nate, and you talk about how dishonest this is and deceptive. Darren was on the school board of Clay County for 17 years. During those 17 years, 14 of those years, they voted to grab from the tax levy, which is levied for the following year, in order to secure funding that never came from the state of Illinois, which is something that you vote on as a general in the General Assembly, as a representative or a state senator. You're voting on the budget that funds our Illinois State Board of Education and the schools that are under the Illinois State Board of Education. So Darren voted on a school board to borrow, not to tax, but to borrow. The levy is already levied. It's just a matter of deferment and borrowing to for future expenses. So that's what they're alluding to. I guess what, Nate? The percentage of 17 years and 14 years is 81%. He voted 81% of the time to increase your taxes. That's where they got 81%. Is 14 of 17 is 81%.
It's crazy. It's just playing games with the numbers. It's exactly what Pritzker's doing with the budget when he talks about, I have a balanced budget. We've balanced the budget in this state. Finally, you wouldn't be anywhere with your budget if you didn't have a favorable federal government backing you up and bailing you out.
The COVID relief fund.
The COVID relief fund. Yeah. Exactly. It's the same type of thing that we're seeing here. Even if I was a very, very casual observer of this race, even if I didn't know a bunch about Bailey or Irvin or any of the candidates, just glancing at what I would know as a casual observer of Darren Bailey, none of these charges sound right. Like in these mailers that the Irvin campaign is sending out, none of the voted Obama into office.
Voted for Biden because they clipped the old Operation Chaos out of context when Obama had already removed himself from the race in 2008 during Operation Chaos, which was Rush Limbaugh's appeal to not vote for Hillary or Clinton,
right,
but to try to disrupt the whole election, that conservatives like myself would pull a ballot in a primary to try to make sure. And when he was asked, well, he couldn't vote for Obama, he couldn't vote for Clinton, who'd you vote for? He says, I don't know. For all I know, I might have voted for Biden. You know, Biden wasn't even in the race at the time, but they clipped that, and now that becomes their commercial that he voted for Biden.
Well, as we said earlier in the show, you know it's smoke and mirrors when, and you know it's such a sign of desperation and deception when you are citing in your mailers your own speeches. The source you are citing is he's citing his own announcement speech for his gubernatorial bid.
If I'm clear on this, it says here are the sources. I hope that you, and I know most of you out there are not taking any time with these things and are pitching them. Enough of you continue to buy into some of these lies, and once again, it's deception. An entire campaign run on deception rather than ideals and ideas and principles, because you never hear where Richard Irvin stands on any of the major issues like the pension funding. But back, like you said, the sources. Aurora Mayor Richard Irvin announces, that's his source from the Chicago Tribune. Darren Bailey remarks at Nini's Deli, you know, That's who they voted for Joe Biden. Basically, somebody shoved was recording their conversation so that you don't get the totality of the conversation. Mark Maxwell, who Bailey defends voting to raise property taxes 81% on local school board. First of all, you don't vote to raise taxes on school boards. You vote for referendums or levies. The people actually vote whether they fund that. That is not a tax. That is a referendum. That is a, and I get it, once again, twisting it, because It's easy.
The money is already allotted. It's just it's how you borrow to cover other it's the levy. It's not increasing revenue. It's
which gets back to something that we both know. Government isn't in the business of making money. Government is in the business of taking money. They take money from you and I, and that's how we afford government. Now, once again, Illinois does not have a revenue problem. It is one of the, it's the fifth largest economy in the nation. It's the 18th largest economy in the world. If to put that in perspective, the country of Ukraine is the 20th largest economy in the world. We are two positions ahead of a country like Ukraine, which unfortunately is going through this horrific conflict, right, war, craziness. I don't even know what to call it because it doesn't even make sense. And you wonder if it just isn't a bunch of political theater where the citizens, the countrymen, are the ones who pay the highest price.
They're just caught in the whirlwind of it all. Yeah. It's of this international gamesmanship.
Well, and I don't want to go too far down the Ukraine and Russia thing because it's a debacle in of itself. But the other debacle is the fact that we have a campaign right now where we have a candidate who is declaring that he is a Republican. And if you're just joining us here at Cities 92.9, the news and talk of Bloomington Normal, I'm David Paul Blumenschein. In studio with me is Nate Byrne. He is a wealth of knowledge when it comes to all things politics. But you have this candidate who is a registered Democrat, who is receiving money from the richest man in Illinois, Ken Griffin. He himself has a pay-to-play position in Aurora because he has a company that Ken Griffin has an interest in. It is typical Illinois politics. We don't usually see it on the Republican side of the aisle. It has just started showing itself over the last 20 years. You talk about desperation. Desperation comes in the Republican Party because a lot of establishment Republicans, career politicians like Jim Durkin, have gotten, they've got in bed with Richard Irvin.
Yeah. I think they see him. I don't know if they're ignorant of a lot of the background noise and the campaign, where the money's going and all that. Or if they know and they just don't care and they think he's a safe bet. I think they see him as kind of a safe bet, and I think they fall for Pritzker spending a lot of money against him, but then simultaneously running ads, making him look bad. You know, there are so many Republicans in this state that I wish would just break out of the establishment mold and just, this state is, it desperate times call for desperate measures. We need more, no one wants to say the word radical, but we need radical solutions to this state's problems.
It's the only way. And what you just said is, it's never about the voters. It's never about you and me and Tony across the way or any of the other population that resides here in Illinois, or the ones that actually have left Illinois. It's always about the party. It's always about positions. It's always about the establishment. As I said, the cabal, the oligarchy. It's never about you and me. When is it going to be about the people? When are we going to return government to, of, by, and for the people of Illinois? Because that's where we're at right now. How do we see ourselves out of this quagmire that we put ourselves in if good, sound people, I love when Tom DeVore says, it's sad to see how many men have abandoned being involved in politics in Illinois. But if it wasn't for the mama bears engaging
the mama bears
during the school board meetings, if it wasn't for them saying, you're not going to do this in school to my children, and they rose up and you saw what happened, Pritzker had to pat that down real quick because he knew he relied a lot on those suburban moms.
Suburban soccer moms.
To win. And suddenly he saw himself losing them. I mean, this is the politics we're seeing. It can be overcome. I know it can be overcome because I'm witnessing it. When you see somebody like a Jim Fisher, who was just in studio with us, and I encourage you to get in contact with his campaign. He's willing to go knock the doors. He's willing. He's a conservative.
Genuine guy.
Yeah.
Just the genuine article.
And it's somebody like him is an Abraham Lincoln, right? Really just upstanding farmer, just wants the best for the people of Illinois, the people of his district. You know, I think that's Darren Bailey. I think that's also Max Solomon, Gary Rabine, Paul Schimpf, even Jesse Sullivan. You know, Jesse obviously is also a target of these particular mailers from Richard Irvin. These are people who truly have ideas. It's fascinating. When they were on the doing the forum at Five Points over in Washington, Illinois, five of the six shared the stage. The one lonely seat on the stage was there for Richard Irvin. He chose not to be a part of exchanging and answering what it takes to truly get us moving forward in Illinois.
Always a winning strategy to avoid the debate stage and to avoid invitations to debate your ideas. Always a winning strategy. Good job, Richard.
But Richard, you're more than willing to fill the mailboxes, which is where we started. You reap what you sow. How are you going to parlay, Richard? And this is what I'm inviting you and your team to come in. You were more than willing to show up at the GOP, or at least your surrogates, the comptroller, secretary of state candidate, attorney general candidate, and one other one, I can't remember. But you guys, your team was willing to show up for that at the McLean County GOP Lincoln Reagan dinner and take the stage to tell us about themselves. But they weren't answering questions. Have somebody from your organization, Richard, get in contact with me. Because I want to know about these mailers. I'm wanting to know how you're going to unify a party after you open up a scorched earth campaign on it. Hey, we're going to talk more about that to end up the show today. When we come back here at Cities 92.9, the news and talk of Bloomington Normal, I want you to stay with us. We're going to try to rally to get out of here today. But that doesn't mean we're not going to be back next Sunday. Hey, look forward to it on the other side of the break here at Cities 92.9, the news and talk of Bloomington Normal. You know, we do so appreciate you joining us here on Sundays from 1 to 3 at Cities 92.9, the news and talk of Bloomington Normal. I'm David Paul Blumenschein. This is the DPB Show. You know what? One of the things that I've learned over my 58 years of life is this, that it is true. When you are entrusted with something, it's a matter of what you do with that. You know, are you a good steward of the land, of the resources you have, or are you somebody that truly twists things and tries to deceive others? Because how does that saying go, Nate? To much is given, much is expected. And when you see somebody like Richard Irvin, who gets a lot of money, and what he does with that is he calls his opponents liars and deceivers, when he truly is the liar and deceiver.
Through lies and deceit.
Yeah. I mean, you've been given so much, Richard. You know what's sad? Whether you're a registered Democrat, which is what you are, or a registered Republican, I don't care what side of the aisle you're on. I want the truth. The truth will set you free. Life is about the truth, and there's nothing truthful about what you have done with your campaign. So therefore, if you're not telling the truth, you're telling a lie.
There's a difference between, there's always going to be sharp disagreements in campaigns and policy, and I fully expect any candidate to point out differences between them and their opponent, but there's a difference between that and just blatant pulling quotes out of context and all these mailers, folks, that people are that I'm sure you're getting flooded in your mailbox with from the Irvin campaign. They're all just about, you know, he said, she said, you know, here's a quote that he supposedly said, which it's false. It's just handing over line after line of just lies from what it looks like.
Well, I do appreciate you coming in studio today and joining us here, Nate. I look forward to your next time because I know you're going to be very versed in more of these literature pieces and commercials from the Irvin campaign. The June 28th is the primary. Hey, 2,000 Mules is out, released by Dinesh D'Souza. I'm going to promise my audience, I'm going to come up to speed. I'm going to watch it. I've heard so much about it. Deals with election integrity. Off air, we were talking about the J.B. Pritzker went to a premiere of that, according to Mark Vargas, who does The Answer up in Chicago. And he said J.B. actually left immediately because he thought they said 2,000 meals, not 2,000 mules. Yes. So Nate, you're going to watch 2,000 Mules.
I'll watch it. Yeah, I'm curious. I'm interested.
Well, we're going to assure you that we're going to have a breakdown on 2,000 Mules because that is where we're going to turn our sights to here on the DPB show because election integrity is so important. Obviously, I know a little bit about that. I was the organizer, or according to the Democratic Socialist of McLean County, I was the origin of terror by organizing a bus trip, Stop the Steal, out to Washington on January 6th, which also now makes me an insurrectionist, too. Glad to hold those titles. But, you know, we're going to break this down because it is important. I don't believe in backing up the bus. I don't think we have to, Nate, in order to have election integrity. What we do need is not to have an overwhelming majority of Democrats stationed in our precincts. We need Republicans to show up and become part of the process.
We need Republican poll watchers, more and more of them.
Well, with that said, you know what? We do appreciate you joining us here this week. Next week, we're going to talk a little bit more about that. Stay tuned at Cities 92.9, the news and talk of Bloomington Normal.